All right, ladies and gentlemen, happy Veterans Day. All you veterans, best holiday, we're talking about today, best holiday in America as far as I'm concerned. Christmas is a close second, though, but great holiday. So, I'll be the MC for this year's Veterans Day ceremony. Today we celebrate American veterans and all that they have done to serve our country. This year I'd like to bring special attention to a matter that many probably don't recognize, they don't realize. Many of the veterans who serve this great nation find it difficult to pursue the American dream. Financially, you know, our soldiers who serve this country don't make a lot of money. One of the other things with that comes the stress and the hardships that they endure. So, unnerving statistic that 17 veterans a day commit suicide. I mean, that's tremendous. Think about that, 17 a day, which of course equals 6,200 a year. And among those, it's our 18 to 34-year-olds, right? That's the most productive time in your life, at least should be. To think that you're in such despair that you take your life is pretty amazing. So, with that said, while it's nice to say thank you for your service, and it's appreciated by most veterans, we need to do more. I think I challenge all of us to look for ways to get involved. Maybe to donate to veterans organizations, participate in veteran fundraising activities, or volunteer your time. There's not a shortage of places to volunteer. So, with that said, there might be some struggling veterans out there. Maybe you know some struggling veterans, right? If you do, they don't have to suffer alone. There's help out there. There's assistance. We got some advocates in this room, and I'll pick Sergeant Mike Kerr here, retired police sergeant. There's a lot of veterans organizations out there. We got to do something about getting this number down. 17 a day is beyond, well, zero is too many. So, with that said, I'll ask everybody to please take a moment of silence to recognize and honor those missing in action and our prisoners of war. Thank you. Please rise for the posting of the colors and remain standing for the playing of the national anthem and the Pledge of Allegiance. Veteran, present, up. Thank you. Jackson, please be seated. I'd like to call up Police Chaplain Pastor Bob Cornwall from the Central Woodward Christian Church and give the invocation.
Join me in prayer. God of peace, we gather today to give honor to women and men who have served their country with dignity, honor, courage. We seek to recognize the willingness of our veterans who have shown a willingness to serve in difficult and often dangerous moments, whether they were drafted or volunteered. As we gather here today, we pray that the spirit of peace will come upon the nations of this world, so that young women and men will no longer be called away from family and friends and put in harm's way. We look forward to the fulfillment of the prophet's words, who spoke of a day when the nations shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. And nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. It is in the hope that peace will reign on earth that we give thanks for those who serve, not only in times of war, but also in times of peace. We give thanks for those who have been present during times of disaster, bringing relief and support to communities in need. We give thanks for the sense of purpose and community that emerged from this time of service. We give thanks for the recognition that service to community is important. We not only honor those who served in the military, but we also give thanks and honor for their families, especially spouses and children who may have waited with bated breath for news of their loved ones who are risking their lives in places far from home. We know the terrible toll that war can have on the lives of those who serve. So we pray for healing of body and mind and spirit, asking that your grace would wash over them, that they would find wholeness in heart, if not in body. We pray that those who struggle in life's difficulties, that they and their families might find hope for the future. We who love this country ask that you not let us forget those who served and continue to serve. May their example encourage us in our own service to community, to country, to world, so that together we might pursue the common good of all creation, here and abroad. Amen.
Thank you, Chaplain Cornwall. Now the Heritage Concert Band of Troy will play each service song. I ask you veterans to stand when your service song is played.
Thank you.
I'd like to introduce our dignitaries with us today. We talk about service. These folks continue to serve at either the state or local level. Their service is appreciated as well. Please hold your applause, and then when you stand, we'll applaud all at you. So, Mayor Dave Slater, Pro Tem Mayor-elect Ethan Baker, Councilmember Ellen Hoderick, Councilmember David Hamilton, Councilmember-elect Ann Erickson-Galt, Councilmember-elect Teresa Brooks, State Representative Padma Kupa, City Manager Mark Miller, City Attorney Lori Bloom, Community Affairs Director Cindy Stewart, former Mayor Gene Stein. I want to recognize Chief Frank Gustafson, Chief of Police of this great police department. Kurt Bowensee, Director of Department of Public Works. Let's give these all a round of applause. It's now my pleasure to introduce the keynote speaker, an Army veteran, retired Brigadier General Donald F. Schenck. Brigadier General Schenck is a veteran of the Iraq War. He had a wide-ranging and impactful career spanning almost five decades of service. That's pretty impressive. To American soldiers and veterans through positions in the Army, and in industry, and also as a volunteer. During his 35-year military career, he led a variety of operational and acquisition organizations focused on protecting America's freedom. He commissioned as an armor officer and has held operational assignments at the company through division level during peace and war. His defense acquisition assignments covered the breadth of the Army and the Marine Corps weapons systems, resulting in the fielding of significant warfighting capabilities for the United States and our allies. Today, General Schenck focuses his energies in a variety of veteran-focused areas. He serves as a key advisor to the executive director of the Fisher House, Michigan, working to raise funds and awareness to build and support Fisher Houses in Michigan. He is a graduate of the Army War College and a Defense Acquisition University. And he has earned academic degrees from McDaniel College and Central Michigan University. His military award decorations include Distinguished Service Medal, Legion of Merit, Soldier's Medal, Bronze Star Medal, Meritorious Service Medal, 5 awards, and numerous service medals. A former resident of Troy, he currently resides in Bloomfield Township, Bloomfield Hills, with his wife, Janet. This time, sir, please.
Good morning to all the significant elected and appointed officials for the city of Troy, most notably Gene. It's great to see you again. Mayor Slater, Mayor-elect Baker, newly elected or returning members of City Council, Mark Miller. Where's Mark? Well, I was going to wish Mark good luck in the transition, because I know this is a significant emotional event for him as he changes leaders within the city. Laurie, it's nice to see you again as well from our work in the past together. And of course, Cindy, it's always great to see you. Citizens of Troy, veteran comrades at arms, and most importantly, families of veterans. I am honored today to offer some brief remarks to you in this great city that I called home for almost 20 years. As a former resident, I know how important this city is in the state, and as a soldier, I know how important the service of everybody we honor today has been and continues to be. I would like to ask all of our veterans, whether you stood when your service song was played or not, to please identify yourselves once again by standing. Thank you very much. And now, would the family members of veterans either serving today or having served in the past, please also stand and be recognized. Thank you all very much, both for your service to the nation and for your service to your family member when looked like, well, I think we had one woman who was a service member when we were off gallivanting around doing the nation's business. Today I address you as a veteran who has seen much, but like so many of us, has repeated only a fraction of what has been experienced, encountered, and endured. All of the veterans with us today, whether they are old, whether they are young, or just youngish, have given a bit of ourselves in the furtherance of an idea and a set of ideals formulated in the 17th and 18th centuries and eventually enshrined in our Constitution. These ideas were of liberty, equality, and justice. These ideals were about the worth of each life. Now, we are not here today to debate or even discuss any of our nation's wars, the missions and budgets of the military establishment, or even America's proper place on the world stage, and when and how it should use its various levers of power. Instead, we are here to honor and recognize those who served our country, regardless of when, regardless of where, regardless of how. Instead, we are here to pay some few thoughts to the why of their service. We pause to recognize their service and their contribution to ideas and to ideals, and we do so ever mindful that our nation is today in the 243rd year of independence because of their service. Today we're gathered in front of this place, envisioned and brought to life by Marine Corps Sergeant Major Jack Turner and Navy Lieutenant Joe Mala. That's the Veterans Memorial Plaza outside. We're gathered here so that we might pay homage to the living and those no longer with us, remembering always that for every man or woman who serves the nation, there is a family member anxiously awaiting their return and carrying on with life until a reunion occurs and some semblance of normalcy is returned. While it's true that I may not know most of those who just stood and identified themselves as veterans, and I certainly do not know everything about them or of their stories, I do know a lot about them and others like them, having soldiered with their likes throughout the United States, Germany, Saudi Arabia, Kuwait, Iraq, and other places. I know veterans such as these because I have served with them, commanded them, led them, and indeed fought with them. I know veterans such as these to be dedicated to such core values as loyalty, duty, respect, selfless service, honor, integrity, and personal courage. I have lived with veterans such as these in far-off places and in distant lands where their mere presence was an affront to some, but to others was a living embodiment of hope, hope for a greater, braver future. I have studied these and other veterans up close, whether in a fighting position, in a tank turret, whether flanking guard or on patrol, in the cold of winter in Central Europe or the blazing, relentless heat in the Middle East. I have lived with them and shared life's many dangers. Like many of you, I have marveled at them in an effort to understand what makes them the brave men whom Ernie Pyle described in his book of the same name, recounting the deeds he observed as he watched their every move in combat in Europe in World War II. Now, what did these veterans all have in common? Throughout the march of our nation's history, they are the ones who unhesitatingly answered the call to arms in defense of freedom. They are the ones who chose to act when others chose to stand aside. They are the ones who took the more difficult path of shouldering the nation's burden to be a light unto the nations. In so doing, they accepted grave risk in physically and emotionally demanding circumstances, fully prepared to tender that blank check made out to the United States government and the American people. Many of you with us today know all too well what we have suffered, not just because of our physical wounds or the impacts of the conditions of our service, but also in the permanently dark recesses of our mind where we grapple with the unseen traumas and horrific demons that come from the stress of combat and the realization that death for us has lurked around every corner. Our veterans took up arms in defense of ideas, that people everywhere should have the opportunity to better lives, that every man and woman should be able to live in safety and in prosperity, and that every child should be able to grow stronger and achieve greater goals and a better life than his parents and grandparents did before. These and all veterans took the notion of the defense of these ideas to foreign lands to be protectors and benefactors to people unlike them in many ways, but ultimately like them where it mattered most, in the common goal and ideal to live a better life where demonstrable progress in improving the human condition can be achieved. Each of these veterans with us today remembers others who are not with us. None of us know why their lives were taken so early, but we do know why they served, because they were called by their country and they answered that call. They served knowing they would see danger, they would be away from family and home, and they did it selflessly. Looking upon you now, I am struck by how dissimilar your names and your service records are on the surface. But when I look closely into your eyes, I see men and women devoted to ideals and to action, men and women to whom giving some was very, very important, men and women who know far too many who gave all, so that we could be here today at this place at this time. What can all of us learn from the lives of veterans, such as those we've recognized so far today, or those taken from their families far too soon? We can learn once again that freedom is not free. It requires eternal vigilance, action, risk-taking, and often the shedding of the blood of America's treasure, its sons and its daughters. We can learn from their determination and courage and sacrifice, which continue to lay the foundation for a more secure and peaceful world, a world that remains an extraordinarily dangerous place, harboring unseen enemies of the very ideas and ideals these veterans sought to protect and for which those not with us today gave the last full measure of devotion. We can learn that the life of a veteran is a legacy to the living, and that for every veteran who is with us today, there are unseen and uncounted legions of the living and of the dead to whom we all owe respect, devotion, and never-ending gratitude. It is to us, the living, to whom these and other sacred responsibilities pass. It is to us to perform the righteous obligation expressed by President Abraham Lincoln in his second inaugural address in March of 1865, to care for him who shall have borne the battle, and for his widow and for his orphan, indeed, to never forget. Our veterans deserve a special place in our hearts and in our minds. And it is a real tribute to the leadership of the city of Troy, past, present, and future, that you have chosen this day and this hour, the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month, to honor all of us by reserving today as a special remembrance. We are all deeply grateful for the honor you have disposed upon us. I want to pay special honor to three young men who were killed in action in the Republic of Vietnam on this day in 1968, 51 years ago. They are John Preacher Britton, 23 years old at the time of his death, Gary Rusty Russ, 21 years old, and Jim Humphrey, also 21. These young men were all members of the 2nd Platoon of Delta Company, 1st of the 35th Infantry and the 4th Infantry Division, led by then Lieutenant Mike Kerr, who was with us to honor their memory. Mike, please stand. I would ask that you allow me to close with a short prayer for soldiers, Marines, sailors, airmen, and Coast Guardsmen. Lord, hold our troops in your loving hands. Protect them as they protect us. Bless them and their families for the selfless acts they perform for us in our time of need. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. This time we'll conduct the laying of the wreath in honor of those veterans who have paid the ultimate sacrifice. Please rise and remain standing for the playing of taps. The 21-gun salute as well. Sir?
Order, halt.
This time I'd like to, everybody please take your seats. This time I'd like to call up Chaplain Cornwall again to conclude the ceremony and the benediction.
As I stand here today, I am not a veteran, but I am the son of a veteran and grandson of veterans. One grandfather served in the Spanish-American War, another in World War II, and my father served in the Navy during World War II. A few weeks back, I was in Oregon visiting my brother, and we were going through my father's some of my father's effects. He'd been passed for many years. And we came across letters and mementos from his years, his time, not years, just time, in the Navy as a gunner on a merchant ship. So he saw the world as an 18-year-old, but faced danger. I never had to do that. I graduated from high school in 1976. The Vietnam War was over. The draft was over. We thought peace might be with us. But since then, many have served. And you who are veterans are honored. General Schenck, thank you for your message. And may we close with these words of prayer. Would you join me in prayer? Holy One, may we go forth from this place appreciative of the lives honored here today. May we follow their example by committing ourselves to service to the community and beyond. May we receive the spirit of friendship that can develop when people come together through public service, including military service. May your spirit empower them so that we together might transcend every barrier and boundary that divides us from one another. And grant us wisdom as we pursue a vision of peace and justice for everyone who lives in this nation and beyond, for we are all your beloved children. Amen.
So, ladies and gentlemen, that will conclude our ceremony today. Thank you all for attending. It's very important. It's very important that we recognize our veterans. So at this time, that will conclude. Thank you all. Remember, if you know a veteran or you're a veteran that's struggling out there, there's help for you, okay? God bless you all. Thank you.